Hi there. Today on Typical Books, we're going to be talking about real horrors in graphic novel format. I am a huge fan of graphic novels. I don't read enough. I haven't read them all. I mean, I have a whole Junji Ito collection. I keep talking about reading and not touching it. I think it's because I have a real soft spot for true crime. And when I say real horror, that's what I mean. You can have some real horror books, like the ones that we have upstairs. We have 30 Days of Night, a classic, The Crow. Those sorts of real good horror graphic novels, Crossed. You know, I love Crossed. That's not what we're talking about today. I don't have that big of a collection, but what I want to do is expand my collection. Part of my reading goals for this year included reading a new true crime graphic novel, and I've got one, and I want more. Now, a lot of these I've talked about on the show. My friend Dahmer was one that I reviewed a long time ago, and I loved it. I absolutely loved this. If you're not familiar, this is about Jeffrey Dahmer by Durf Backdurf, a friend of his that had illustrated him in high school, of all things, and then later on, years later, had mulled over this idea. So from the back of the book, if you want to read a really heavy story about a disturbing teenager, my friend Dahmer will certainly quench your dark little desires. But this book is about a lot of other things that matter much, much more. The institutionalized weirdness of the suburban 70s. What it means to be friends with someone you don't really like. A cogent explanation as to why terrible things happen. And a means for feeling sympathy toward those who don't seem to deserve it. And yeah, those are things that we can all relate to, I'm sure. Especially after a certain age, you know, getting out of high school and stuff, and years later reflecting on people that you knew. And yeah, I love the style of this. Of course, it's black and white, but it is, you know, sort of a funky 70s style. This guy really liked, you know, that Rat Fink sort of look. And you can tell from the cover what sort of style this book pretends. And it's just a wonderful story. You've no doubt seen the film, and this is a national bestseller now, a major motion picture. I hadn't heard of it before. It was teased that it was going to be made into a film, and the film is amazing and a real heart-wrenching, wonderful story, and so dark and so terrible. It's not like the Dahmer Files. You know, I'm a big true crime fan. I've watched a lot of Dahmer stuff. We have the FBI files in the house, and hey, I like true crime and I like the real nitty-gritty story, but the story of those who lived around and with and up until the time that this person was caught, it doesn't dwell on the murders at all. It doesn't even dwell on his first murder. It dwells on what he was like as a teenager in his formative years. And formative meaning like forming into a serial killer, unfortunately, but such a great book, illustrated so wonderfully, and it was really one of the first true crime graphic novels I read. Then, skip forward many, many years later, The Green River Killer. Jeff Jensen and Jonathan Case. Jeff Jensen's father was one of the investigators, lead detective, I believe, and maybe the singular person that kept this case alive after he'd been caught and, like, investigating a lot of missing and murdered Indigenous women and others, just missing and murdered women in general in the Seattle area. From the back of the book, Eisner Award-winning graphic novel. A lot of these are, too, like award-winning graphic novels. It's not just, you know, doom and gloom and guts and gore and bleeding and leading and all that stuff. It is wonderful art, gorgeous stories, dark, dark, dark stories that have, you know, for the lack of a better word, entertained us for centuries. Detective Tom Jensen spent nearly 20 years preparing to ask a monster one question. In the summer of 2003, he got his chance. For 188 days, the detective charged with hunting the worst serial killer in U.S. history, Seattle's Green River Killer, responsible for the slayings of more than 48 women and girls, not only got to interview Gary Leon Ridgway, but practically lived with him. It is harrowing. And I've seen a lot of true crime stuff. I've followed the Gary Ridgway story. I mean, he's still in prison, still looking good, unfortunately. Like, we follow these stories of these people in the news whether it be from the beginning, the unsolved cases, when they're apprehended, or later on. You know, you may have seen some Edward Kemper news in the news recently. That story is old. He's old. And we still follow this sort of thing. So reading this, as I did with Dahmer, I knew the story. Reading this, though, you get the spine-tingling horror feeling in some of the reveals and some of the way that the story is built, because it's being told in a non-traditional way that we've never quite heard it before. And I think that's why we love listening to true crime podcasts, even if we already know the stories. It's told in a new way. And the art in this, of course, is a little more realistic, a little more like noir looking. It's just black and white, and it's very, very plain, very simplistic. Yet that is what really lends the few cells that are slightly graphic so much gravity, because they are just intense. And I'm certainly not going to show anything too intense here today, because that's not what it's about. It's just, if you've read this and you've read other books like it, let me know. A few years pass and I got very interested in The Last Book on the Left. Now, it isn't a graphic novel in that it's not an Eisner Award-winning story made by very well-known illustrators, and it's not told by the son of the detective or the friend of the killer. It's these three goons. One of them is a bigger goon than others. He's been, for all intents and purposes, canceled. Ben Kissel. Marcus Parks, though, and Henry Zebrowski. Let's talk about them and what a wonderful job they did. Specifically Marcus Parks. From what I understand, his life became creating this book you see here. And they talk about the heavy hitters, the gold star killers, all of the big biggity bigs. And it is a haunting, hilarious examination of history's most notorious and cold-blooded serial killers from the creators of the award-winning Last Podcast on the Left. It's tough to call it a podcast because that's in there, eh? The podcast, Last Podcast on the Left. Since his first show in 2010, The Last Podcast on the Left has barreled headlong into all things horror as hosts Marcus Parks and Henry Zebrowski, and now they have some other guy, cover subjects spanning Jeffrey Dahmer, werewolves, Jonestown, and supernatural phenomena. Deeply researched but with a morbidly humorous bent, the podcast has earned dedicated and aptly cult-like following for its unique take on all things macabre. And I love this show. I don't listen to every single episode. I don't listen to the side stories a lot. Sometimes I do, but not always. It's the Gold Star Heavy Hitter series. I mean, they had an episode on Israel Keyes, and Henry Zebrowski's imitation of his laugh has stuck with me forever, for better or for worse. Now, of course, it is a lot of text, but it is heavily illustrated in color, and it's got little factoids, almost like a peach pit guide to JavaScript or a dummy's guide or something, and they've got these little call-outs and factoids, and it's just a wonderful, wonderful book. So I wouldn't say a graphic novel necessarily, but it is wonderfully illustrated. Some of them are quite disturbing, of course, but they're all just wonderfully illustrated. If you love cool illustration, if you like a book that offers a little more than just a linear reading experience, and you like this sort of serial killer stuff, if you're new to true crime, this is a great primer. Or, of course, if you have a serial killer fan in your family, this would be a really good gift. So because of that show, Marcus Parks and Henry Zebrowski not long ago had Harold Schechter, an author, journalist, on the show. And he's written about a lot of stuff. He's written about a lot of killers. But they talked about a few books that inspired him. And then he talked about Did You Hear What Eddie Gein Done with him and Eric Powell. It is, again, sparsely illustrated, but so wonderfully touching. And it does retell a same story that we've heard time and time again. The Eddie Gein story. What Eddie Gein went through as a child. What Eddie Gein done. Where Eddie Gein went to the graveyard, digging up corpses. Where Eddie Gein did with the bodies. Like, it's terrible, but it's not super graphic. For a graphic novel, it's not very graphic. We've got a gray tone as well. It's not all just black and white. It's not color though, but it's got tones of gray, very similar to the cover. The cover does not lie. It's the way that it's illustrated. And it is just that Wisconsin death trip that we all know and love. From the moment his unspeakable crimes are discovered in November 1957, the story of the Wisconsin ghoul Ed Gein gripped the world's imagination with mythic power immortalized in the forms of Psycho's Norman Bates, the Texas Chainsaw Massacre's Leatherface, and the Silence of the Lambs' Buffalo Bill. The mild-mannered, seemingly harmless farmer from the tiny town of Plainsfield was more monstrously deranged than any of his make-believe avatars. Yes and no. I mean, I think you could have ventured onto his property unannounced and made it out alive, but still, such a harrowing, touching story, and one of those, again, that I have already known and you know well, probably, if you follow true crime. But this just tells it in a more gentle nature. I think it's a very approachable book and really good for those that are new to true crime or true crime in this graphic novel format. I believe it was kind of a labor of love for Harold Schechter too. And it was interesting to hear him talk about it. I think that set me up really well for it. And it's just a gorgeous book too. I found it used at a second in Charles in Pennsylvania. So it was just a lucky find because I was having trouble finding it on the shelves. Now, of course, we've gone kind of back in time as far as serial killers go, and forward in time in my terms of discovering them. So now we have a brand new release, something that I have not read yet and I'm going to read. It was a recommendation from a coworker, so thank you so much for recommending this, Torso, the Cleveland Torso Killer. And I am very excited to get into this. If we want to talk stark, black, noir, sort of style, this is a very plain, very minimalist looking graphic novel. I'm very excited to get to it. And, you know, I don't know everything about this story either. It's an older story. Cleveland, 1935. Elliot Ness, fresh from the legendary Chicago triumph over Al Capone and his associates, had his sights set on Cleveland. He went on a crusade that matched and sometimes even surpassed his past accomplishments, but dismembered body parts started washing up in a concentrated area of Lake Erie Sound, headless torsos that left no clues to their identity or reason for death. Elliot Ness and his colorful gang of unknowns chased this killer through the underbelly of Cleveland for years, and as far as the public was concerned, he was never captured, but what really happened is even more shocking. I don't know. I didn't know Elliot Ness was involved in this. So I would fail the Torso Murders trivia night. But now, maybe with the help of this book, I'll be better prepared. So yeah, again, Pat, who recommended this book, thank you so much because I'm excited. And it also brings me to, have you read any of these? Have you read Torso? I guess it's fairly popular. Dark Horse Books put this out. I got it off of Amazon. I don't go out shopping as often as possible, so I wanted to make sure that I could get it into my grimy little paws as soon as possible. But I didn't know if it's been popular. I've never seen it out in the wild, and we do peruse the graphic novel areas often enough. I had a hard time finding... Did you hear what Eddie Gein done? I had to order the last podcast on the left book. I've had to basically order all of these except my friend Dahmer, which I could find at Amazon because it was being turned into a movie. Are these as unpopular as I fear? Have you read a lot of these? Are there other true crime graphic novels that you would recommend aside from Hell? I don't know why I don't have From Hell. I'm going to get From Hell, but yeah. Do you have any others to recommend? I'd be very curious. Thank you ever so much for watching, and have an ooky, spooky day.